But try to understand on the other hand that everything in this world is constantly and continuously in need of obtaining life from God. If it is cut off from God, it will vanish. Nothing in this world can stay without the that radiation of life from God flowing to it. No light can be there in this hall unless the powerhouse is working. And there is a proper connection between this hall or this masjid and the powerhouse. Unless the proper connection remains between the things of this universe, the universe itself will vanish. Now the problem has been solved there in the same manner as we solve here as creatures of God. That in the powerhouse the voltage is very high. Then we establish transformers. Transformer of the highest capacity, then transformer of a lower capacity, then transformer of a still lower capacity, and then bring it down. So in this we imitate Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What He did was that when He created this world, He first of all created the first transformer. Otherwise the world would never have come into existence. He first of all created the first transformer, and then the process started. And that transformer is the heart of the Holy Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. And it was a transformer not only for that time, it is a transformer up to all time. Because its need is for all time. Because its need is for all time. Therefore, it is a transformer for all time. It is the liaison between God and this universe and ourselves included. People say, why do you take the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam as the wasila? Is not God Almighty? Let me repeat. That He is wasila not because God needs it, but because we need it. Not because God needs it, but because we need it. Remember, God is Almighty. When He sent the Quran for guidance of mankind, He was wise, all wise and almighty. He could have communicated this Quran in some other fashion without making the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam as the medium. The entire text of the Quran might have been found inscribed in the heavens in letters of gold and might have stayed there for a period of 23 years so that human beings may write it down. God is all powerful. Wallahu ala kulli shayin qadeer. He is all-powerful. But being all-powerful, why did He adopt this? Why did He make Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam as the wasila? In order that humanity may get the Quran from God. Here He made the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam as the wasila, as the medium. He made it. So for the hidayah or for guidance, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made the Holy Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam as the wasila, which even a child knows. Then read the Quran. For maghfirah, which is another very important thing, every human being wants to be forgiven his sins. For the maghfirah and the consequent salvation, the Quran again makes the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam as the medium In the Holy Quran, God Almighty says, وَلَوْ أَنَّهُمْ إِذْ ظَلَمُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ جَاءُوكَ. If those who commit sins come to thee, O Prophet عليك الصلاة والسلام, جَاءُوكَ فَاسْتَغْفَرُ اللَّهِ, then they seek forgiveness from God. وَاسْتَغْفَرَ لَهُمُ الرَّسُولُ, and the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam also seeks forgiveness of God for them. لَوَجَدُ اللَّهَ تَوَّابَ الرَّحِيمَ, then they will find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as the acceptor of repentance and as the bestower of mercy. The verse is clear. The words are clear. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is making it a condition for the acceptance of forgiveness. For the realization of this fact of forgiveness, here he is making the Holy Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam as the wasila. Then read a hadith. Of course, I generally don't talk about the hadith, because about the hadith, people can say, you see, it is not as important as the Quran or not as authentic as the Quran, but I have spoken from the Quran. Read a hadith also from Sahih al-Muslim, in which it is said that a person, one of the Sahaba, one of the followers of the Holy Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, who was blind by birth, and medical science and even common sense can say that anybody who is blind by birth, his blindness cannot be cured. Who was blind by birth, he one day came to the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam and said, sir, I know that I am blind by birth, and I know that as a Muslim I should remain contented with whatever God has made me. But I don't know why this desire has been there in me that I should come and speak to you, that if you may pray for me, then God will give me eyesight. The Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam asked him to perform the ablution and to read two rak'ahs of nafl prayer and ask him the dua to pray during prostration. And in that dua, the dua is, O Lord, I ask thee through the wasila of thy beloved Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, who is the Prophet of mercy, Nabiyur Rahman. And in the prostration, again the other words are, O Prophet, I ask thee to intercede for me. And this man, when he raised his head from the prostration, his eyes were as good as of any other person. Why did the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam teach this to him? Which means that the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam has been given that status. And because this world is a world based on law and not on haphazard activity, God has made this law that he has fixed a proper channel, and the proper channel is the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. If anyone wants to go to God, he must come through proper channel. This is the law he has fixed, not because he is in need of it, but because this universe and all his creatures are in need of it. To bring this argument that when God is almighty and when he hears all prayers and when he sees everything, when he knows everything, what need is there? No need for God, but need for us. And this is proved by the Quran. This is proved by the authentic hadith. I should not have brought this topic. I have to speak on the Mi'raj. But this is a part of that topic that unless we understand as to what is the personality of the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, the problem of his flight into space to the great beyond and beyond that would remain inconceivable for us. It will either remain dogmatic. If we believe, it will be a dogma, which we don't understand. We will say that we have been taught like this, so we believe. Or if we are of the new modernistic type Muslim, then we will say this is all bunkum, could not have happened. Our dear friends, let me emphasize this point, that the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam has two levels of personality. One is the cosmic level, about which I have been speaking. The other is the historical level, as he is known in history, which is called in philosophy the phenomenological level, from phenomenology. These are two levels of his personality. Now, look at him. Even from the point of view of the historic level, we all believe that he was God's prophet. He was the messenger. The last messenger of God, of course, but he was the messenger. Now try to find out from the Quran whether the Quran makes any distinction between him and other prophets. Is he a prophet like other prophets, or is he something extremely superior to all of them? In this short lecture, I can't go into details, but I'll place before you two very important points from the Quran. The first important point is, read the Quran with the idea of knowing this particular point, which is very important, that wherever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addresses a prophet, Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam, Sayyidina Ibrahim, Sayyidina Nuh, or anyone else, Sayyidina Isa or Sayyidina Musa, he always addresses them by name. Ya Adam uskun anta wa zawjuka al-jannah. Ya Isa, Ya Ibrahim, Ya Nuh, Ya Musa. Every prophet is addressed by his name, but not the Holy Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. The Holy Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam has not been addressed by name even at one place in the Quran. Why? He has been addressed either as Ya Ayyuhan Nabi, O Prophet, or as Ya Ayyuhan Rasul, O Messenger. This at the official level, at the level of his office, the office which was entrusted to him. He has been addressed either as Ya Ayyuhan Nabi, O Prophet, or as Ya Ayyuhar Rasul, O Messenger. This at the official level, at the level of his office, the office which was entrusted to him. But then comes the relationship between God and himself. This was his function for human beings. What relationship he had with God, then he is addressed as Ya Ayyuhal Muzammil, Ya Ayyuhal Muddassir. Now, the meaning of this Ya Ayyuhal Muzammil we can understand O thou who art wrapped in thy mantle. And the meaning of Ya Yuval Muddassir also we can understand. But then there is a third category of addressing. Yaseen. Yaseen wal Qur'an al-Hakim innaka la min al-mursaleen ala sirat al-mustaqim. What is the meaning of the word Yaseen? Nobody knows. Taha ma anzalna alayka al-Qur'an litashqa. What is the meaning of Taha? Nobody knows. Now, remember this. Why do you not like to address a person by his name? If you think on this problem, you will find that either out of respect, a person whom you respect, you will never call him out by his name. You will never call out your father by his name. Oh, so and so, come here. You will call him father, not by his name. Or out of love, you give some name to your child, but you call him with another name which evolves in the process of love. In English also you might say darling or honey or anything of that sort. That is not the name. So this is decided that when a person abstains from addressing another person, from calling him by his name, and calls him by some other epithet, which may be meaningful or just meaningless. Ya Ayyuhal Muzammil is meaningful and Ya Ayyuhal Muddassir is meaningful. But these are the epithets of love. And Yaseen, its meaning we don't know. Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows and His beloved Prophet alayhi salatu wa salam knows. We don't know. We don't know what is the meaning of Yaseen and we don't know what is the meaning of Taha. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has treated the personality of the Holy Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wa salam in this unique manner in the Holy Quran by placing him in a different category from all other prophets to prove, don't think of Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wa salam in the manner in which you might think of anything else, including Prophet of God. And unfortunately, Muslims are not in the habit of reading the Quran and trying to understand what is there. There is a verse in the Quran, وَإِذْ أَخَذَ اللَّهُ مِيثَاقَ النَّبِيِّينَ لَمَا آتَيْتُكُم مِّن كِتَابٍ وَحِكْمَةٍ. Remember the time at the dawn of, remember the occasion when at the dawn of creation Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala assembled all the prophets and took a pledge from them, made a covenant with them. Is akhazallahu mithaqan nabiyyin. What was that? He assembled them. And there was the istima or the hafla as we have in Milad Sharif. When we celebrate Maulud of the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, we imitate what God did at that time. We imitate that thing. Remember that. That He called the mahfil of the Anbiya alayhim salatu wasalam and He remembered His beloved Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam to them. He was not called, mind you. Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam was not called. The other prophets were called. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told them, لَمَا آتَيْتُكُم مِّن كِتَابٍ وَحِكْمَةٍ. When I sent to you the book and the wisdom, summa ja'akum rasulun, then after every one of you has done his mission, has got that kitab and that hikmah, then comes a particular messenger of mine. Summa ja'akum rasulun. Musaddiqun lima ma'akum. Testifying to the veracity of your mission. If taught is correct, he will testify. Musaddiqun lima ma'akum. Testifying of that which you will teach. لَتُؤْمِنُنَّ بِهِ وَلَتَنْصُرُنَّهِ. You will most surely take the oath of allegiance and loyalty to him, and you will most surely help him. Now remember, these prophets were to come before the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu. What does it mean? What does it mean? How can those prophets who came before him, how could they help him? But this was what God Almighty demanded from them. I'll tell you what it means. قَالَ أَقْرَرْتُمْ وَأَخَذْتُمْ عَلَىٰ ذَٰلِكُمْ إِصْرِي. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then asked them, do you make this covenant? Do you affirm this what I have told you, that you will do it? And you give your pledge on this? قَالُوا أَقْرَرْنَا. All the prophets said, we accept this mission wholeheartedly. قَالَ فَشْهَدُوا. God said, then be witnesses to this covenant. وَأَنَا مَعَكُمْ مِنَ الشَّاهِدِينَ. And I am the other party in this covenant. What was this? What was this? Here the Holy Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam has been singled out as a unique personality among all the divine messengers which were to come before him. Of course, he was the last. It means what has been said in the hadith, and which again the materialistically minded maulvis and ulama of today try to deny its authenticity. The hadith is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to his beloved Prophet alayhi salatu wa salam, لَوْلَاكَ لَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْأَفْلَاكُ. O Muhammad alayka salatu wa salam, if I had not created thee, I would not have created anything in this universe. This Quranic verse means this, that all those prophets and all those messengers who came from the time of Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam up to the time of Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam, their mission was to build up the foundations, to build up the road, so that when their leader comes and he gives Islam in its perfect form, then the preliminaries would have been perfected by that time. They were coming not in their right, but every one of them was a khalifa. Every one of them was for this purpose, that the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, when he comes, the message, its foundations may be built in all parts of the world. لَتُؤْمِنُنَّ بِهِ وَلَتَنْفُرُنَّهِ. And may I, by the way, just in passing, mention here the second advent of Sayyidina Isa ala Nabiyyina wa alayhi salatu wasalam. Some of our people are puzzled at this. As to why Sayyidina Isa alayhi salatu wasalam should come again? And why, if he was a prophet, he should come as the Khalifa? All prophets are Khulafa of the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and only that. It is not that he himself will become the Khalifa when he comes. They are prophets and at the same time Khalifa, because that mission was given to them, لَتُؤْمِنُنَّ بِهِ وَلَتَنْصُرُنَّ, that you are his assistant and the Khalifa is the assistant. لَتَنْصُرُنَّ, you will function as his assistant. So if Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam comes as his assistant, it does not violate his status as prophet. Mind you, Musa ala nabiyyina wa alayhi salatu wa salam was a nabi, and Harun ala nabiyyina wa alayhi salatu wa salam was a nabi, and the Quran proclaims clearly that Harun was the Khalifa of Musa. So this argument is best, or this way of thinking is best. All these anbiya alayhim salatu wa salam paved the way for the mission of their leader who was to come as last. To fulfill that pledge on behalf of all the anbiya, that they will function as his assistants, they will assist in his mission. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala selected Isa alayhi salam. He was born from a virgin, given a unique human constitution, different from other human beings who are born of father and mother. His virgin birth actually was meant for this purpose, that he may be able to live a long life, live up to the time that he is needed in order to assist the mission of the Holy Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. And so he will come to fulfill that pledge which was given by all prophets, and because he was the last among them, therefore this mission has been entrusted to him, that he should come at a time when the Muslims find themselves absolutely nonplussed. And those who say that they are Christians, when that time comes that they will hold sway in the world, then he whose name they take, that we are Christians, this Christ will come to assist the mission of the Holy Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam on behalf of all prophets of God who came from the time of Adam up to his day. When we think of all these things which are in the Quran, about which there can be no two opinions, is it still difficult for us to understand that the Holy Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam has a personality which is unique in entire creation, and consequently this glory of the performance of Mi'raj is also unique? It was conferred only on him and on no other prophet of God. There are prophets who are mentioned there, Rafa'nahu makanan aliyya, they were elevated or raised to certain heights in the cosmos, but for none of them the Quran says what it says about the Holy Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. Wan najmi idha hawa, the Quran says about him, and I would like you to remember the incident of the life of Sayyidina Musa ala Nabiyina wa alayhi salatu wa salam, which I just now spoke about, that he begged of God that he wanted to see him, and what happened after that. About the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wa salam, we are told in the hadith that Jibreel alayhi salam came. I would like to emphasize here certain important points only. That a surgical operation was performed on the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wa salam, and that after that surgical operation, there was a vehicle which had come from outer space, and the vehicle was Barraq, and Barraq means an electrically propelled vehicle. An electrically propelled vehicle, its driver or pilot was Jibreel alayhi salam. The vehicle was an electrically propelled vehicle. It was sent from outer space. And in that vehicle, the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam performed his journey, which is unique journey in the history of entire creation. Then he reached at a point where Jibreel alayhi salam said that neither this vehicle nor I can pass beyond this limit. Because if we pass, the electronic charges are so powerful that we will be burned to ashes. And then it is said that Rafraf, another vehicle, was sent to him. We know about fuels nowadays. We fly the aeroplanes with petrol, but we fly the rocket to the moon not with petrol, but with the atomic fuel. There are different types of fuels which we use in our various vehicles. In the railway carriage, in that engine, we use coal and water. That is the fuel. In the automobile, we use petrol of the coarser type. In the aeroplane, we use petrol of the more refined type. Then in the capsules and those rockets which go to the moon, we use something very different, that is atomic fuel. The very first thing in this connection to convince us that it is not a fiction is that all these things were told at a time of human history when no human being had any idea of the power of electricity. The idea of the power of electricity came to the human beings just a few centuries ago through Faraday, who found this current and found the way of employing. The idea of an electrically propelled vehicle was impossible in those days for anybody, not to speak of the Arabs, who used to ride on mules and camels and horses only, but even for the Chinese and for the Greeks and the Babylonians and the Indians or anyone else. How could this term be used 1400 years ago, which has become a reality today? How could it be used? If it is a forgery, if those ahadith which mention it are forged, how could a human being think of it 1400 years ago, that the vehicle which was sent was Barraq, it was an electrically propelled vehicle? Who could have decided that? Therefore, to try to think that the ascension of the Holy Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam with his total personality is something which is inconceivable. Try to think in that fashion would be wrong. Taking it from the other side, as I was speaking last night, the human being essentially is a spaceless, timeless being. He is made, if we can use the term, of course, according to Quran, even antimatter can be reduced to a finer state. But even that antimatter about which modern science affirms that antimatter also is spaceless, timeless. The real human being, the essential human being, is a spaceless, timeless being. The Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wassalam was also a human being. So essentially he was also a spaceless, timeless being. And this human personality has different gears. I might give you an illustration. There are gears in the aeroplane. When the pilot puts the aeroplane in a certain gear, then the aeroplane can run on the runway. Run. When he puts another gear, then it can fly. When he puts another gear, then it can come down. They are different gears. The vehicle is the same. The thing is the same, but there are different gears in that. And the same vehicle can be used in different directions, in different methods. Making a run on the earth is not the same thing as flying in the air. But what do you see every day when you travel? He puts on the first gear so that it makes a run. Then he puts the second gear, starts flying. This human personality, it has got different gears. Normally that gear is there in which we live, this mundane world, physical body, our bones, our activity, physical activity, walking on the earth, we can't fly, we can't do anything. We are chained to it as if that gear has been set and then it has been locked. But if the other gear can be used, which was used by God Almighty for the Holy Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wassalam's ascension, through that operation which has been spoken of in the hadith, his gear of existence was changed. It was changed to his own nature as a spaceless and timeless being. And when his entire personality changed its level of existence and became through and through a spaceless and timeless being, then space and time could not withstand any question can arise as to how could it go. And may I tell you, my dear friends, I want Muslims to read physical sciences and then they will become better mu'mins. Einstein has said, you see, about this time also, because of our ignorance, we have weird notions and wrong notions. May I tell you the time is of different categories. There is one time which is called mechanical time. There is another type of time which is called psychological time. There is another type of time which is called biological time. There is another time which is called metaphysical time. Then in connection with this mechanical time again, there are two types of time. Serial time, in which the human being lives, and universal time, in which the human history lives. Universal time in which the human history lives. History. The individual lives in serial time, history lives in universal time, which comprehends the past, present and future. All right. Then, in terms of mathematical nature of time, time is minus time, time is plus time, time is zero time. Of course, this is very well known. To every student of science in this world who has gone to that height, extent of education. A very eminent scientist of this century has said, he says that if you fly above the earth, to a distance of 500 miles, then through his equations he has come to the conclusion that you will be arriving at a point where time is zero. Then he says that if you draw tangents on the earth from that point, then the angle which is formed will be the angle of plus time. Inside that angle all time is plus, in which we live, of course, we live in plus time, because every day our life is moving forward, we are so many days old or so many years old and so on. This is plus time. Then he says that if you extend these lines of tangents on the other side and make the obtuse angle, then that obtuse angle will be the angle or the region of minus time. Here is a scientist, mind you, not a theologian or anybody else of that sort. A scientist is saying, he says that this region of minus time is like this, its nature is like this, that if a human being is 40 years old and he travels into this minus time for 5 years, then travels back in another 5 years, then when he comes to the point of zero time and tries to enter this region of plus time, when he had started he was 40 years old, so in these 10 years you ought to have been 50 years old, but actually he will become 30 years old. This is not a fairy tale, my dear friends. This is pure science. It is the teaching of those who have performed this miracle in this 20th century. And they were able to do it because they know about the nature of time, they know about the plus time and minus time and zero time and all that. You also know about the speed of light. In science we are told that the speed of light is the highest speed. But which light? Again the question arises. In light again there are different types, categories of light. Crude light is this which we see. Alpha rays, beta rays, delta rays, gamma rays, X-rays, infrared rays, ultraviolet rays and cosmic rays and so on. The laws which govern these different types of lights are not the same. Now, imagine that vehicle which was sent by God for the Holy Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam was made in such a fashion as to exceed the speed of light in its finest form. In how much time could it have traversed 500 miles? I think in no time. Light travels, even this coarse light travels tremendously. Alright, in no time he would have arrived at that zero time. And then it was minus time.
And consequently, what is said in the hadith, that when the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam came back, his quilt was still warm, because he was traveling in minus time. And during this age, those who are undertaking journeys to the moon, they talk about weightlessness. You must have read in the paper. What is this weightlessness? It shows that that region is such, the farther you go away from the gravitational pull of the earth, that region which starts from here and goes up to the end of the cosmos, wherever it is, that region is such that unless a thing is spaceless and timeless, it can't travel there. I mean to say, this region of from the earth to the moon, in this they have noticed this weightlessness, and they take precautions against that, that their bodies might not burst into pieces. You see, those capsules are insulated by different metals and by different electronic vibrations whose nets are built up around them. So the simple thing is that to say that the Mi'raj was bodily or spiritual, it can be the talk only of those persons who are illiterate. If a person has learned a bit of modern science and has got a bit of akal here, then he knows and he can understand it very well, that the Mi'raj of the Holy Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam was with his total personality as transformed into a spaceless and timeless personality. It is only a matter of years. You see, as in the aeroplane, it all depends on the pilot. He sets one gear, then the aeroplane runs on the runway. He sets another gear, then it flies. He can again come down and then again run and again fly and again come down and again run and again fly. Now, my dear friends, the topic is very vast and very difficult, and I always try to avoid such topics in public meetings.